and worship you in spirit and in truth, dear God. We thank you for having a desire to be here, dear God. We thank you that we come, dear Father, to gather together to hear your word, to learn your word, to hide it in our hearts, and to obey, dear God. We thank you for your love for us because you gave your son, and we thank your son because he gave his life. And we praise your holy name because you are a good God. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. We can't thank you enough for your goodness, dear Father.
Thank you, Lord.
We know when it began. It began when you began, dear God. And we thank you, dear God, that it continues. We praise your name now and forever. For it is, Lord God, in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. And I have a thought for you. Jesus said to Thomas, "You believe because you have seen me. Blessed are those who believe and yet have not seen." Jesus was talking about me. We will now have baptism.
Amen.
Good morning.
Morning.
Good morning to everybody else. This is the day that the Lord has made. We, of course, we know that one of the main ordinances that we do is taking Holy Communion. But the other ordinance that we have in the church is baptism. And today we are so blessed that five people have given their hearts to Christ. Yes, come on, they're on their way to heaven already. Hallelujah. They have confessed Jesus Christ as their Lord, and now you and I get an opportunity to experience their outward display of their inward change. So at this time, we're getting ready to go to the water. Amen. This is Riley Nicole Arnold. This is Riley Nicole Arnold. She has made a profession of Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. So Children's Church. This is Lady Kira Nicole Jean Holmes. And according to her faith, we're going to baptize her in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy We didn't want to leave any brothers out.
Religion. I know I've got religion. Oh, yeah. I've been saved.
Carter Dwayne Mowry. And according to your faith, we're going to baptize you in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
All right. Great, Carter.
Something. Hallelujah. Welcome to Holy Week. Hallelujah. Come on and give God glory for Jesus. This is the day of his triumphant entry into. And listen. They stood there with palms, and we didn't bring no palms today, right? So just hold the palm of your hand up and wave it. Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed be he who comes in the name of the Lord. Come on and put those same palms together and give God a praise in this house.
Hallelujah.
Come on, he didn't have to do it, but he did, but he did, but he did. He could have changed his mind, but he did. He did it anyhow. And so as a result of that, we say, oh, magnify the Lord with me. If you can stand, please stand. If not, just praise him in your seat. Come on, put those hands together.
Okay. Oh, magnify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised. By the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised.
Oh, let's just have magnify.
Oh, magnify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised.
Oh, magnify.
Oh, magnify the Lord, for he is worthy to be praised.
Oh,
Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock. Blessed be the rock of my salvation. Hosanna, blessed be the rock. exalted, the Lord named it, and blessed be the rock.
We worship you today in this place. And we call you Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. The great I am, the Holy One of Israel. And we honor you in this place, God. We say thank you, Lord God, for all that you've done for us. You didn't have to do it, but you did. And for that, we are grateful, God. We are grateful.
Yes, God.
Jesus.
Jesus.
At the mention
of your name, every knee will bow and tongue proclaim.
Savior,
you are Lord, and you are God.
Hallelujah. We bless you, God. We bless you, God. Come on, everybody in the house.
Jesus.
We call you.
Jesus.
At the mention
of your name. Every knee will bow and tongue proclaim. Jesus,
you are Savior,
you are Lord, and
you are Savior, you are Lord.
I praise you.
I praise you.
I praise you.
I praise.
true and living God. You're the true and living God.
That's why I love you.
I love you.
I love you.
I love you.
Brother,
come on.
And having a great father, you can always depend on and count on them. When you're in school and you get in trouble, I'm going to get my big brother. That's who I'm going to get. My big brother, Jesus Christ, the Lord and the Savior.
Hallelujah, hallelujah.
And then I can call on my daddy, and when my daddy show up, things are going to happen.
Hallelujah.
I call on God, hallelujah. And with him comes Jesus. With him comes the Holy Ghost. With him comes power. Either one of them. Look them dead in the eye. With all 32, 12, 10, 2, whatever you got. Come on, just look them in the eye. And say, I am happy.
I am happy.
Glad.
Glad.
That Jesus.
That
saved me.
Saved me.
Come on and give God one more prayer.
Everybody's all excited and all worked up already. Excited for the Lord. Let's give the Lord a hand clap. Amen, amen, amen. My name is Daryl Atkinson, affectionately known as Brother D.A. I am here to do the appeal for tithes and offering. This is the opportunity where we all get an opportunity to take part in our services today. So, the scripture and the reading of his word that I will be going from today will be Galatians 6, verses 7 and 10. Again, it is Galatians 6, verses 7 through 10. And the word reads, "Do not be deceived. God is not mocked. For whatever a man sows, that he will also reap. For he who sows to his flesh will of the flesh reap corruption. But he who sows to the Spirit will of the Spirit reap everlasting life. And let us not grow weary while doing good, for in due season we shall reap if we do not lose heart. Therefore, as we have opportunity, let us do good to all, especially to those who are in the household of faith." And this is the word of God. So basically what the scripture is telling us is giving tithes and offering with hope for how God will use it is sowing to the Spirit. And this hopeful giving empowers the church to collectively sow the Spirit as it does good. So you give good, you give good to God, God gives good to you. And the Spirit does what the same as well. So there are four ways here to give at SBC. First, you can give online at sbcmonrovia.org and select give. Second, you can use the Vanco app. And third, you can mail to P.O. Box 479, Monrovia, California, 91017. And lastly, you can complete our brown envelopes. Somebody hold up a brown envelope for me. I know you. There you go. See the brown envelopes? You can hold up your brown envelopes. And according to my wonderful, loving wife, she says, please, because she's the church administrator, please make sure that you fill them out legibly with your full and your first and last names. So, with all that being said, ushers, will you please serve us?
Thank you. Amen. So as we prepare for the Word of God, I would just like to encourage you to think about, number one, why is salvation important to you? Why is it important to you? And then as you think on that, begin to thank God for the thing that you're excited about. Just kind of lift your hands up and begin to tell God, thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
Thank you, God.
I thank you for your salvation because, and whatever your because is.
Hallelujah.
Whatever your because is, just begin to thank God for it.
Thank you, Lord.
Thank you, God, because if you didn't save me where I was, I wouldn't even be here.
Hallelujah.
God, if you didn't pull me out of the hole that I was in, I would be with some of those same friends that's not here today, God. But I'm grateful for that. I'm grateful for that. God, if you had not saved my mother or saved my father, God, I don't know where I would be, God. And for that, I'm grateful. God, thank you for saving my son. And thank you for saving my daughter, God. And for that, I am grateful. Thank you, God. You didn't have to do it, but you did. And I want you to know I appreciate it. I'm not ungrateful, but I thank you, God. I thank you, God. I thank you. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah.
For the things that you have done. Yes, I'm grateful for the things to reach we want. I could go on and on and on about your word. I'm grateful, grateful, so grateful just to praise you, Lord.
Flowing from my heart,
flowing from my heart, are the issues of my heart. For the things that you have done. Yes, I'm grateful for the victory we won. I can go on and on and on about your word. Great. flowing from my heart, flowing
from
my
heart.
Are the issues of my heart, it's gratefulness.
Yes, you wipe my tears, Jesus.
Yes,
you've been a friend.
Yes.
Yes. We give you praise, Father. Praise you. Hallelujah.
I'm all a diva.
Yeah.
You bet I'm all a diva.
Time ago, Brother Charlie, I learned that when I was a boy, you just couldn't jump in the bathtub when the water was there. Mama would run the bath when we were little, and you just couldn't jump in because the water was too hot. And today, it's hot in here. It's hot in here. Bible says, for those who are wondering, the Bible says, where the Spirit of the Lord is, there is liberty. And that liberty is you can praise God, you can worship Him, because He's worthy of our praise. Hallelujah. He's worthy. Hallelujah. Oh!
Hallelujah. Yes, God. Listen. Let me tell you something. Listen. You don't know what people go through just to get here. And sometimes we look at folk funny when they're praising God. But if you've been through what some folk have been through, you would be praising God too. You'd be dancing. You'd be shouting. It's by the grace of God. The grace of God. The grace and the mercy of God. Hallelujah. Oh, my God. If we're going to do it, let's just praise Him. Come on and give God some praise. Hey. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Hey. You don't know. You don't know. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Hey. Hallelujah. The Lord today. How about you? Anybody just love God? We love Him. We just love Him. Just love Him. I just love Him and I thank God for Him. We honor Him today. We honor Christ Jesus, who is the head of the church. It is in Him that we live, we move, and we have our very being. It feels good in here today. Man, we're grateful to God for all of you wonderful people of God, to our pastors and ministers that serve, our deacons and deaconess, mothers in Zion and officers, and all of you wonderful people of God. Any first-time visitors here today, will you wave your hand? Let's praise God for our visitors. Thank God for you. Come on, let's praise God for our visitors being with us on today. We are so grateful to God for all of you being with us on today. And we pray that you just experience the love of God and the fellowship of His children. And we pray that you will have a life-changing experience today. And not only today, but we pray that in days to come, you'll remember that you were here and how God met you. So once again, thank you so very much to our visitors and guests. Thank you for being with us on today. So glad to see all of you here today. I'll try not to get in trouble and call names, Sister Cece, but I'm just glad to see you on today, you and Father Cyrus. So glad to see you. As a matter of fact, will y'all help me do this, because you knew I was going to do it. Will you just greet your neighbor and tell him it's good to see you in the house of the Lord? Will you just greet them? Greet them. Good to see you in the house of the Lord. It's good to see you in the house of the Lord. I want to do just a little bit of housekeeping and go right to the word of the Lord on today. As you all have, many of you have, were here and you experienced or witnessed these wonderful people of God who are already saved, already on their way to heaven. But today we got an opportunity to see an outward expression of their inward change. And Jesus is Lord of their lives. Their names are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. And we are so grateful to God for them. We get an opportunity to give certificates to them. And I want them to come forward with our deaconess at this time. I want them to come forward. We baptized him today, but we do not have his certificate because he... We found out yesterday he finished with his classes. He was ready to go to the water. And that is Brother Tony Jordan Cameron. Stand up, Brother Tony. We're so proud of him. You come stand with him also. We're going to make sure that we give. But today we want to just give these certificates to these wonderful sons and daughters of God. This is a certificate of their baptism. This certifies that each name that we read out, they were baptized in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit on this 24th day of March in the year of our Lord, 2024, by myself, Pastor Chris Bourne, and Diaconah James Harvey. Wes, I need Big James to stand up. Let's praise God for him. That's, amen. And this is... certificate for Riley Nicole Arnold. Let's praise God for Riley. This is a certificate for Lady Denim Roy Gambler. Let's praise God for Denim. This is for Kiara Holmes. Let's praise God for her. And this certificate is for Brother Carter Mallory. Let's praise God for him. And one more time, let's praise God for each of them that have given their life to Christ on today. Thank you. All right. Thank you so much. Amen. Now they're going to children's church and everything else. Hallelujah. By way of just a few announcements, this week is Passion Week. Somebody say Passion Week. Passion Week. This week is the week that leads up to the highest of holy days. We will celebrate our resurrected Savior. And not only did he rise then, but he's still alive. I'm jumping ahead of myself. He's still alive. And we want to take time and remember, and I want to encourage you to study scripture. Just read. Just read the scripture. And I know that you're going to be blessed in the word of the Lord to see all that our Savior went through for us. Amen. So we look forward to inviting and seeing each and every one of you, those who are visitors and guests and family members on next Sunday. We want to see you here in the house. Amen. As we lift up the name of Christ Jesus on next Sunday. Next Sunday. Amen. April the 6th is shredding day. If you need some paper shredded and all that, you know, bring it up here beginning at 8 a.m. 8 a.m. from 8 till noon. 8 till noon. Right here. It's free of charge. Amen. Free 99. Free 99. That's a new one, y'all. I'm coining that. Free 99. Bring it on up here and shred it, and you will be glad that you did. On the 13th day, the 13th of April, we're looking forward to having our leadership meeting. All leaders here at the church, we're looking forward to meeting at 10 a.m. on that day. Amen. Somebody don't be waking me up early, Pastor. So we look forward to meeting you. Amen. If you have your Bibles, I want you to go with me to St. Luke. St. Luke's Gospel, chapter number 20, St. Luke chapter number 19, beginning at verse number 28. St. Luke chapter 19. If you don't mind standing for the reading of God's word, if you don't have it, they'll be putting it up on screen. St. Luke chapter number 19, beginning at verse number 28. One more time. St. Luke chapter number 19, beginning at verse number 28. When you sit, got it, say, I got it. If you don't, say, wait up. Okay, I got three wait ups. St. Luke chapter 19, verse number 28. It's in there. Here we go. Reading from the New King James version of the Bible. When he had said this, he went on ahead, going up to Jerusalem. And it came to pass when he drew near to Bethphage and Bethany at the mountain called Olivet, that he sent two of his disciples, saying, go into the village opposite you, where as you enter, you will find a colt tied, on which no one has ever sat. Loose it and bring it here. And if anyone asks you, why are you loosing it? Thus you shall say to him, because the Lord has need of it. So those who were sent went their way and found it just as he had said to them. But as they were loosing the colt, the owners of it said to them, why are you loosing the colt? And they said, the Lord has need of him. Then they brought him to Jesus, and they threw their clothes on the colt, and they set Jesus on him. And as he went, many spread their clothes on the road. Then as he was now drawing near the descent of the Mount of Olives, the whole multitude of disciples began to rejoice and praise God with a loud voice for all the mighty works they had seen, saying, blessed is the King who comes in the name of the Lord. Peace in heaven and glory in the highest. Can you say amen to the word of God? If you go back to verses 30 and 31, Jesus has sent these two disciples and he says, go into this village opposite you, where as you enter, you will find a colt. Another version says you will find a donkey tied on which no one has sat. Loose it and bring it here. Today, I want to tag this text and talk to you from the subject of wild donkey on the loose. Wild donkey on the loose. Will you pray with me? Father, we thank you and praise you for this time of coming to share your word with your people. Thank you, dear Lord, that your word is quick and powerful and sharper than any two-edged sword. I thank you, dear Father, today that you know exactly what we have need of. So I pray and ask that you first forgive me of every one of my sins in thought, word, and deed. And I ask, Father, that you will stand in my body and speak through my tongue and anoint me afresh, God, to declare your truth to your people. And I thank you that we will have ears to hear and hearts to respond. And I give you thanks in advance for what is to come. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. You may be seated in the presence of our God. Wild donkey on the loose. It's quite interesting when you observe people and how many times people will associate or label themselves as some sort of an animal. For it was the late great Muhammad Ali who said, I float like a butterfly. Yeah, y'all heard it. And sting like a bee. Yeah, it was the late great Laker fans, Kobe Bryant, who called himself the Black Mamba. Black Mamba. Let me bring it on home. It's somebody who sang up here on this worship team today. Her name is Donna, but she likes to be labeled as Butterfly. Butterfly. People have these discussions on Michael Jordan or LeBron James or Tom Brady being the GOAT. Y'all heard it. when you look at political parties, the Republican Party is elephants. The Democratic Party, donkeys. The deltas, elephants. I ain't calling them elephants, but they have that as their label. The omegas are the dogs. Woof, woof. They're dogs that do that. And I thought about that when you think about labeling. Jesus, our Savior, Reggie, is known as the Lion of Judah. But he's also the Lamb of God. But very rarely, if ever, do we find anyone labeling themselves as a donkey. As a donkey. There was in scripture a father, Jacob. Jacob gathered his children together in Genesis chapter 49, verse 14. And Jacob labeled his children, and he brought his son Issachar. And he called Issachar in Genesis chapter 49, verse 14. He called him a strong donkey. Lying down between two burdens, he did that. And because, you know, people don't like to be labeled as a donkey. In our human vernacular, don't even say it, but they, you know, it's another word that they might label a donkey, a big-eared donkey. A donkey that makes noise like, I mean, it sounds like they have an asthma attack. A donkey. I went to visit Brother Greg Brown and Sister Priscilla. I went, y'all pray for Brother Greg. So glad to see my brother. But while driving up to visit Brother Greg, there was these signs that I saw. I saw these signs, and they're going to put these signs up, these signs, this sign. Had a big yellow donkey on it. Then there was a sign that said a big yellow donkey. And then another sign that popped up had the nerve to say donkey crossing. This was in the neighborhood. Tony, this was in the neighborhood, and they had donkey crossing in the neighborhood. You know, at that point, I almost turned around. Hallelujah. I was almost turning around. I'm like, what in the world? And then a little later on, after I got there and talked to Brother Greg, Brother Greg explained to me that these donkeys are wild, and they can just come into your yard. So he sent me some pictures of these donkeys in his yard and sent me these pictures of donkeys in his front yard like they are birds. In his front yard. You see these donkeys in his yard and these donkeys in his yard, and y'all already know that I have not been back since. Hallelujah. I've been back since to see him. But I found out about these donkeys. These donkeys are wild donkeys, and they can come in your yard and they can eat and do as they please, and there is nothing you can do about it. They are protected by the state. They are wild donkeys. Wild donkeys. And these wild donkeys, I thought about it. While these donkeys are protected by the state, and what makes these donkeys so special? So, of course, I had to do a little research, and I thought about donkeys and what makes donkeys so special and why are they so valuable to us. And even if you take a close look at donkeys, how many of us may have some of the same characteristics as some of these donkeys. Because donkeys have played a major part in human existence. When you look, you can find that donkeys played a great part in helping those that were carrying water and food. They were there to help transport things. They were hard workers. These animals, they would plow the fields for those that were in agriculture areas. They would plow the fields so that they could plant. They these animals, these donkeys, they're very sociable animals. They're calm creatures for the most part. They are very intelligent. And then I even looked to find that they are labeled as pets. Some folk have donkeys as pets. They have donkeys as pets. We can never, Sister Heather, have a donkey as a pet. These donkeys are hard workers. They're service animals. They are peaceful, and these donkeys are humble. But in order for donkeys to be ridden, these donkeys had to be broken. They had to be trained. And I know we're on our way to Resurrection Sunday, but before we get to Jesus rising, we have to understand that Jesus took a ride on a donkey. This happened in the year of AD 30. AD 30. It was where we find this narrative on today, which is labeled as Palm Sunday. And throughout scripture, you'll find that on Palm Sunday, not all scriptures label and talk about palms, but all of these scriptures talk about this donkey. Let me help you with that a little bit. In Matthew chapter 21, verse number 8, you will see where Matthew writes, and he talks about that a very great multitude spread their clothes on the road, and others cut down branches. Some cut down branches from the trees and spread them on the road. But then in Matthew, that same chapter 21, verse number 2, says, go into the village opposite you, and immediately you will find a donkey tied and a colt with her. Loose them and bring them to me. So we see the donkey and the colt. And we hear about the branches. In Mark's gospel, Mark chapter 11, verse number 8, it talks about how many spread their clothes on the road and others cut down leafy branches. Leafy branches. And then they cut down from these trees and then they spread them on the road. But then in Mark chapter 11, verse number 2, we find that Jesus says the same thing. Go into the villages, and as soon as you've entered there, you're going to find a colt tied, and on which no one has sat. Loose it and bring it to me. So you find that in Matthew, and then you find it in Mark. Then you go over to John's gospel, chapter number 12. John chapter number 12. Look at what John says. John chapter 12, verse 13, he says, they took branches, here it is, of palm trees, and went out to meet him and cried out, Hosanna! Blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord, the King of Israel. In verse 14 of John chapter 12, he says this, then Jesus, when he had found a young donkey, sat on it as it is risen. Can you say amen? Here it is. So we see only in the book of John do we find the palm branches. We find branches in Mark, and we find leafy branches in Matthew, leafy branches in Mark and branches in Matthew, but only in the book of John do we read about a palm. And as we read in our text, the Bible doesn't even mention in Luke anything about a tree. But they all talk about this donkey or this colt. Why is this donkey so important? Jesus, the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords. He's the King. And most of the time, kings didn't ride on donkeys. Kings rode in on horses and they had chariots. But King Jesus rode in on a donkey. And he rode in on this donkey, listen, to fulfill the prophecy and the word of God. The Bible says in Zechariah chapter 9, verse number 9. Zechariah chapter 9, verse number 9. Rejoice greatly, O daughter of Zion. Shout, O daughter of Jerusalem. Behold, your king is coming to you. He is just and having salvation, lowly and riding on a donkey, a colt, the foal of a donkey. Can you say amen? Here it is. Let's get on the freeway and roll a little bit. Jesus riding in on a donkey didn't make him less of a king and Lord as he is. As a matter of fact, Jesus riding in on a donkey showed his true humility. It showed that he was willing to fulfill the word and plan of God. Can I help somebody real quick? Child of God, you can still be great. Listen, and be humble at the same time. See, there's some people who feel like I gotta ride in certain things. I gotta live in certain neighborhoods. I gotta wear certain clothes. No way, Jose. Listen, you can be the bomb.com and be lowly and be kind and fulfill the purpose and plan of God in your life. I'm preaching up in here, up in here. Jesus rode in on a donkey. You got to understand that as a child of God, you were great before you had your job. You should be great before you live where you live. You should be great before you drive what you drive. But you want to make sure that you humble yourself and make sure you fulfill the plan of God for your life. Look at your neighbor and say, fulfill his plan. Wherever you are, whatever you do, you want to be humble. You want to make sure you are obedient to fulfill the plan of God for your life. Are y'all still with me? Yeah. Jesus rode in on a donkey. He rode in on a donkey. What can we learn in just these few minutes from Jesus and this donkey? How can this narrative relate to us? I'm glad you asked that, Brother Keith. Let's look at the text back in Luke chapter number 19. The Bible tells us, he says that in verse number 29, it came to pass that when he came near to Bethphage and Bethany. Bethany is the word that literally means house of figs. Bethphage is also the word that means house of unripened figs. But Bethphage, when you take a look at it a little closer, Bethphage is literally known as a place where grace is realized. Stay with me. I'm going somewhere. He sends them ahead and he tells these guys, he says, you're going to go opposite of Bethany and Bethphage, the place where grace is realized. In verse number 30, he says, you're going to go into this village opposite you. And when you enter this village, you're going to find this colt that is tied, that no one has ever sat on this colt. I need you to loose it and bring it to me. Can I chrysorize it for just a few minutes? Here is what you have to understand. The first thing, child of God, is we see that Jesus sent for the donkeys. I'm gonna help somebody real quick. Jesus sends out these two disciples. Notice these disciples in the text are nameless. Come back to that. Because many times people want their name to be known as to what they're doing for the Lord. Let me try this side. If your name ain't called, but God has told you to do something, you don't worry about nobody calling your name. You just know that he chose you to do what he wants you to do. Oh my God. He sends these unnamed disciples out and they go and they find this donkey, just as Jesus said. This donkey is tied to some sort of a post of some sort. And this donkey, you find out, didn't tie himself there. But somebody tied him up. This donkey had never been broken. He had never been trained. And this wild donkey is out in public, but he's tied up. But Jesus says, I need you to go get him. Go get him. He's tied up. He's there. He's not like those donkeys at Brother Greg and Priscilla's house. He's tied up. No one has sat on him. No one has trained him. No one has guided him. No one has nurtured him. But Jesus sent for him. Yeah. Try it again. I used to be slow. No one has sat on him. No one has broken him. No one has trained him. He doesn't know the 66 books of the Bible. He doesn't know the 18 articles of faith. He ain't been to Sunday school. He ain't been to new members class. But Jesus sent for him. Yeah. Oh my God. Spencer, give me a little bit more up in here. I need you to understand, child of God, that Jesus is sending, and he sent out his disciples looking for this donkey. And when he finds this donkey which normally would be bucking and kicking, this donkey which would be heeing and hawing, this donkey in our world might be cussing and fussing. But he sent for the donkey. Jesus sent for him, and he says, loose him and bring him to me. Release them from what's been holding them. Something that's been holding them, I need you to loose them from it. Here is what that means. The truth of the matter is how you and I can relate to this donkey is because some of us, truth be told, just look straight at me, we've been tied to all kind of stuff. Some stuff has bound us. We've been bound. Truth be told, yeah, we've been tied in sin and iniquity. Somebody has been tied in bad relationships. Some folk have been tied up to addictions and habits and things that are not good for their life. Some folk are tied up mentally in your negative thoughts and things like that. But whatever it is, it's tied you up. But child of God, there's good news today that God is sending a word to you to tell you to loose him and let him go. How many people want to be free today? I want to be free. I want to be free. He sends him to this place where grace can be received. So grace can be received. And I thank God for his word that he sent people. God will send people to you wherever you may be. Let me help five of us and I'll make six. Sometimes God sends people to you and it may not be for you to be in the church. Because God will send somebody on your job. God will send somebody at the supermarket. God will send somebody with your children's play dates that will help you know that God is looking for you. And he's come to you not so you can stay bound, but he came so that you might be free, child of God. He's looking. He's looking for you. He's looking for you. He sent these two disciples, and these disciples went and they found this donkey, and he told them, loose him. Let him go, untie him, and bring him to me. Here it is. Here's why he did that. Is the second point is right there in verse number one. Verse number 31. I'm sorry. He says, if anyone asks you, Manny, why are you loosing him? Why are you untying this wild donkey? You give him one answer, because Jesus has purpose for him. Because the Lord has need of it. That's pretty much the end of my speech, Sister Debbie Jean. That's pretty much it. That the Lord has need of them. There were some people who were there and they were watching these disciples as they went and they were untying this donkey. They were watching and they were looking. It was the previous owner, and the owner's wondering, why are you coming and loosing my donkey? Why are you messing with my car? You know, it's like, can you imagine somebody comes to you and says, I need the keys to your car. And you say, well, why do you need the keys to my car? The Lord has need of it. Come on. Now, what is that going to look like? I'm coming to your house. I need the keys to your house. Give me the alarm codes and everything else. Why do you want my house? Because the Lord. Now, what would that sound like to you? Some of y'all are thinking, see, come back in. Y'all done went carnal on me. Here it is. Listen at these guys. These disciples only did what Jesus told them. And watch what happens. The Bible says, the person asks, why are you loosing this donkey? Why are you untying this wild animal? Why are you taking my property? Why are you doing what somebody else has done? That sound familiar to anybody? Don't you know, Pastor, that they're unchurched? Why are you using them?
Pastor. They ain't been to all of the meetings. I don't know. Pastor, they don't even know all the hymnals in the red book. Because the Lord has need of them. Can I tell you something, people of God? Sometimes we need to get out of our way and let God have his way. Because you don't know how God is moving to save, to deliver, to heal somebody. And many times we say, well, if it didn't happen the way I know how it went. And we miss the move of God. The owner of the donkey was the one that says, why are you unloosing my donkey? And they said, because the Lord has need of him. They gave him the keys pretty much. Here, you can have the keys. Sister Debbie, if I ask for the keys to your car, her glass is fogging up. She just, because for us, in our minds, we're thinking, I ain't giving up nothing. But this man, here it is. God knows how to move on the hearts of people to know how to change their ways and their minds so that when God has need of things, that people will be ready to give it up. Are y'all still here? Let me keep on moving. Because the Lord has need of it. That's a word for somebody today. The Lord has need of you. You've been tied up. You've been wondering, man, how am I going to get out of this? And God has sent you a word today. Listen, you've been going through and you've hearing these words. You're seeing people shouting and things have been happening. You get little texts and tweets and all of that stuff. It is because the Lord is trying to speak to you because he has need of you. He's trying to loose you from those things that have been holding you, those things that have been binding you, those people that are no good for you. God is trying to loose you. Because he has need of you. Will you look at your neighbor and say, God has need of you? Okay, I'm almost there. I know it's hard. I know it's hard for people to think that God has need of them when they say, I ain't been to church. I don't know the church stuff. I don't wear the church clothes and all. I know that, you know, but can I tell you something? God knows how to change your heart. And when he changes your heart, it'll be easy to change your clothes. Yee! That's a good one right there. God knows how to change your heart. Too many people want to deal with the outside. God wants to deal with the inside. Let him change your heart. Let him change your mind. And then you'll change your attitude. Okay, all right, all right, all right. Because God wants to save. God wants to use us. And listen, God wants to use us for his glory. Somebody say, for his glory. For his glory. So that's why he wants to deliver you. That's why he doesn't want you bound by addictions and all of this stuff. That's why he don't want you to stay in sin. Lord have me, I don't know where I'm going now. That's why he don't want you to do that, because God has need of you. God wants to use you for his glory. So you cannot continue in the life that you know is not pleasing to him, especially when he sends people to give you the word of God and give you an out. God always gives you an out. Okay, he's going to give you an out. All right, let me keep rolling. So here's why he did that. Here's why he did that. He did that because, here it is, because the donkey had purpose. This donkey was loosed for purpose. Here it is, verse 35, and I'm almost done. What was this donkey's purpose? This donkey's purpose was simply to carry Jesus. I know that was real deep. Let me give you one more time. What was this big-eared, wild, untamed, untrained, hee-hawing donkey? It was to carry Jesus. Look at what the text says, verse 35, and I'm almost there. They brought him, meaning the donkey, to Jesus, and they threw their clothes on. They threw their clothes on the donkey, the colt, and they set Jesus on him. Verse 36. Here it is. And as he went, back it up one more time. They bring the donkey to Jesus.
They throw their clothes on him. They sit Jesus on the donkey, and the donkey starts riding, walking. I used to be slow. Came and they threw their clothes on the donkey's back. They set Jesus on the donkey, and the donkey starts riding, walking. He's walking. Jesus is riding. And as he's riding, the Bible says that the disciples and folks start hollering and they're screaming. They're shouting. But as the donkey is walking, the people start throwing their clothes out. They weren't throwing their clothes out for the donkey, but they were throwing their clothes out for who was on the donkey's back. And this untrained donkey, all he had to do was make the right step. He had Jesus on his back. He was on his way to Jerusalem. And y'all know anytime untrained animals hear loud noises, they can go crazy. But this donkey kept on walking because Jesus was on his back. And while they were shouting, "Blessed be the man who comes in the name of the Lord," while they were shouting, "Hosanna, save us," this donkey kept on walking. He kept on walking all the way to Jerusalem. And child of God, that was the donkey's purpose. And I came to tell somebody, your purpose today, once you give your life to Jesus, is let Jesus get on your back and you just keep on walking. You walk when they holler. You walk when they don't, because your purpose is to carry Jesus. I wish I had a song for it. I think I do. Ride on, King Jesus. No man's gonna hinder me. Just take the right step and let God do the rest. This donkey showed us that you can be tied, but God will set you free. This donkey showed us you may not be trained, but God can still use you. This donkey showed us that you fulfill purpose when you carry Jesus. Who are you walking with? What are you stepping on? Know that it's not about you, but it's about the one that you carry. It's about the one that you carry. It was about Jesus. This donkey had no idea that Jesus was on his way to be crucified. He had no idea. The Bible speaks nothing else of this donkey. It doesn't say that he went out and pastured in the fields of Jerusalem. But his purpose was to carry Jesus. And the people were throwing branches and palm trees. And they were throwing their clothes. How many gonna throw their Gucci Prada? They were throwing their clothes. They were saying, "Hosanna," which means save us. Here's the problem, Stanton, here's the problem. They were saying save us today, but a week later, there was hollering, "Crucify him." No matter what, the donkey kept on walking. I want to tell somebody, I know you're going through challenging times. I know it's difficult. You got tears in your eyes. But can I tell you, whoever rides your back will get in your head. And if you have Jesus with you, he's going to begin speaking his word. "I'll never leave you, nor will I forsake you. I'll be a very present help in the time of trouble. I was wounded for your transgressions and bruised for your iniquities. The chastisement of peace was upon you, but with my stripes, I'm healed. Who's on your back? Because who's on your back can get in your head. This donkey shows us that we all have purpose. Thank you, Father. Here it is. For somebody, you need to know this. Please hear me. If God can use a donkey, if God could use an untamed wild donkey, how much more can he do with you? How much more can God do with you? How much more can he do with you? But will you let him? Will you let him get on your back? No, thank you, Father. Will you let him come into your heart? Will you let him come into your heart? People are so quick to want to do certain things certain ways. And what we've done many times is we've tried to put God in a box. This donkey shows us, man, we don't know how God will move on the hearts and minds of people. What if those disciples would have been like some of us? Jesus, you know, I know Brother Ron over there at Bethphage. Him and Brother Charlie, they ain't too quick to let their animals go. But they simply obeyed. When they got over there, Brother Ron may have asked, what are you doing with my donkey? He said, the Lord has need of him. And all he could do is back up and say, okay. When God sees you and how you relate to people, when you let them know God has a plan for your life, the Lord has need of you. Well, you say, I don't know what I can do for God. I don't really know what I can do. Listen, this donkey, all he did was walked. He just walked and carried Jesus. What if God just wants you to carry him into your neighborhood? What if God just wants you to be kind and show the love of God? What if God just, you know, you can pray for people. You can ask him, how can I pray for you? You will do something to show his glory as you simply obey him. But it starts with you having a relationship with him. Ma'am, sir, listen, if you're here today and you know, listen to me, hear this, please. You know that you're like the donkey tied up. You know it. You know it. We ain't gonna trip. You know it. You are tied and you've not given your life to Christ. And today you hear this word and you know, man, I've been bound, I've been tied. But you feel God telling you today is the day I want to free you. I need you to do something so bold. I want you to come. I want to pray with you. We want to pray with you and pray for you. If you've never given your life to Christ Jesus, I need you to come. This is so important. If you've been bound, you say, Pastor, I know that that's me. Don't trip on anybody else. Come. I'm going to come down. I will walk with you. This is so important. If that's you, ma'am, because one of the things as the Lord was showing this to me, he was just showing me that there are so many people who are just tied up and bound. And so often the Lord comes to set them free. And they say, well, nobody has come to loose me. Well, today we came to loose you. Came to loose you. If that's you, ma'am, will you come? Will you all just sing a little bit as they come? That's you. Will you come? Come. Don't miss this moment. It doesn't matter where you've been, what you've done. God loves you. God cares for you. Jesus died for your sins. But you got to give him a chance to come into your heart. That's you, ma'am. Maybe you say, Pastor, I'm already saved, but I'm just bound. There's some addictions. There's some habits. There's some things that I know, and it's been holding me back. But today I want to be free. If that's you, will you come? Will you come? Don't you worry about people. Listen, don't worry about people. This is you and God. Will you come? Will you come? Will you come? All we want to do is pray. We want to pray with you and pray for you. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Thank you, Jesus. We're going to give it a few more minutes. I know God is tugging at someone's heart. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. Those who are online, if you text that number, we have men and women available to pray with you and pray for you. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Father. Who's on your back? Who's in your head? Hallelujah. Are you fulfilling the purpose God has for you? Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Let our peace. Hallelujah. Thank you, Father. One more time. One more time. Thank you, Jesus. Maybe you need, every believer needs a church home. If you sense God leading you to become a part of this body of believers, we welcome you. If that's you, ma'am, if that's you, sir. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Jesus. You feel God leading you to become a part of this family of God. We welcome you to come. We welcome you to come. Hallelujah. Don't miss this moment. Let's pray. Let's just pray. Father, in the name of Jesus, we love you and thank you. God, we give you all glory, honor, and praise. Thank you, Father, for the lessons that we may have learned from this wild donkey that you loosed. I pray today for these your sons and daughters. Father, I know that all did not come. I sense your spirit. And God, that apprehension that kept them there, I pray that you will continue to tug at their hearts before it's everlasting too late. I thank you, dear Lord, that you love us so much that you come to set us free. For you said, whom the Son has set free will be free indeed. So I pray today, God, that you will begin to deliver my brother and my sister, the things that have bound them, the things that they have been tied to, the people and relationships that are not from you that they need to disconnect from, the habits and addictions, Father God, the sins and iniquities, Father. I pray today, dear God, that you will even take away the taste and the desire as they get closer to you. In the name of the Lord Jesus, I pray, Father, that you will help us know that you have need of us. And we thank you, God, because you're so God, so much God, that you can do what you need without us. But thank you, Lord, that you love us so much that you want to use us for your glory. I thank you, God, that there's purpose for each and every person here. I pray that you will awaken the purpose, awaken that dream, awaken, God, what you've laid on their hearts, Father, so that they might, God, fulfill the plan of God in their lives. I pray that you will give dreams and vision. God, unlock those doors that have been closed, Father, so that they can move, God, in the things that you have desired for them to do. Now, Father, I pray that all of us leave here, God, with you, and that we will just walk with you. God, that you will be with us, Father, and that others will see you in and through us. I pray that in the name of Jesus. And forgive us, dear Lord. Forgive us when we fail to acknowledge you. Forgive us when we fail to obey you. But today, Lord, we want to make sure that we're doing the right thing, God, by obeying the purpose and plan you have for us. So, Lord, there's so much more that we can ask and pray. I thank you for these that have come. God, you know their need. God, I pray your blessings, God, upon each and every one of them. Those that desired, that reached in on the prayer line, I pray for them, God, that you will be with them. And Father, we give you thanks and praise for this and so much more. And we ask this in Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen and amen. Can you help me praise God for these? Oh, let's praise God for Sister Brandy and Brother Glenn Payne. They want to be a part of our church family. Oh, we're so good. Praise God for them. Amen. Come on, let's do better than that. God is adding to the church. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Amen, amen. Listen, I pray that you were blessed and encouraged. Praise God for our music ministry and all that took place on today. And I just pray that you are encouraged in the word of the Lord. Let's have a wonderful week in God. Is that all right? Can we have a great week in God? Let's expect Him to do great things. I'm expecting God to do great things this week. I'm expecting healings. I'm expecting great reports. I'm expecting great things from God. Hallelujah. I'm positioning myself for the great things He has for us. To all of our visitors and guests, once again, thank you so very much for coming. Come back and see us again. Amen. Let's stand on our feet. Nothing else? Am I forgetting anything else? Good, good, good. All right. Praise God. Will you just bow your heads or grab your neighbor's hand? That's even better. Amen. Grab your neighbor's hand. Father, thank you once again for this time of worship and praise. Thank you, dear Lord, for all that you have done for us. Thank you for the example of this donkey. Now, Father, as we prepare to leave this place, we never leave your presence. We pray and ask that you will go before us and clear out the path. Stay behind us and have our back. Stay underneath us and keep us standing. Stay over us and keep us covered. But Father, we thank you that you live within us. And you've said, greater is he that's within us than he that's in the world. So I pray, God, your healing, your strength, your peace, your comfort be with each and every one until we meet again. And we give you thanks for it now. In Jesus' name, amen and amen. Have a great weekend, God. God bless you.
Whoa.